And so let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, and I'm going to read 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and I'm going to read five key verses that have become my life mission. What do you say, my life mission? And your life mission. Well, I want it to become your life mission because I believe the church must arise. Can you find it for me, honey? I'll get all fingers and thumbs. All fingers and thumbs. It's one of the reasons I memorize a lot of scriptures, because you can spend an awful lot of time up here flicking around. And you've got to go quickly because the Lord's coming soon. Somebody lift your hands and pray with me and say, Father, bless the message today and let miracles come into my life with the gifts of the Spirit, so that miracles start by faith from today. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, Paul is speaking and he says, and I, brethren, which means everybody, men, women, boys, girls, when I came to you, I did not come with excellence of speech or of wisdom, declaring to you the testimony of God. So Paul's saying, when I came to you, I wasn't powerful of speech. Then he says, but I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ. Everybody say, except Jesus Christ. See, there's the key. Keeping everything Christocentric. Big word, but what it means, keep Jesus in the center. When Jesus is the center of our lives and the focus of our lives become glorious. But when anything else takes the focus and the center, our lives become blocked up. So he needs to be Christocentric in our life. When Jesus is the center of our lives, then five things happen. Everybody say, the will of God, the word of God, the ways of God, the works of God, and the wonders of God start happening. Why is that? Because miracles happen with a spirit of faith. The Bible says in Hebrews 11:6, without faith it is impossible to please God. So if you're not in faith, you're in something else. It's called fear. And fear is false evidence appearing real. False evidence appearing real. The Lord wants us to stay in faith. Somebody say faith. Because when faith is growing in your heart, according to Romans 10:17, you hear the word, you believe the word, then God gives you the faith to preach the gospel. He gives you the faith to get married. He gives you the faith to step out of the boat. He gives you the faith to start a business. Who agrees faith is more powerful than fear? Why? Because fear is reverse, but faith is forwards. And so week in, week out, we're not preaching messages here to entertain you. We are preaching faith to feed you. Who wants more faith? Then starve your doubts and starve your fear and start feeding your faith. And to feed your faith takes a program. Say a program. That means every day, read the Bible. Every day, hear the word. The first thing I do when I wake up is I get my Bible on. And I've got a beautiful with it. Nowadays, there's so many on the websites where you can have the music and the scriptures playing. How many of you do that? It's a powerful thing. You've got to feed your faith. Somebody say, feed your faith. Because faith will get you to do miracles. Amen. And in Romans 14:23, the Bible says, whatsoever is not of faith is sin. You think about that. If you're not in faith for tomorrow, you are actually backsliding into sin yesterday. Smith Wigglesworth, one of my favorites, whoever heard of Smith Wigglesworth? Smith Wigglesworth said, if you're not on fire more this morning than you were yesterday, you backslid in the night. Praise God. How many think, how many think you might have backslid in the night? There's a few of us. But the Lord says, come on, faith. Faith made Peter get out of the boat. Faith made Smith Wigglesworth pray for 23 people to be raised from the dead. 14 are documented. Now, you see, let me tell you, higher criticism and postmodernism and the doctrine of the cessation of the apostles' miracles has crippled the church in the West. So what's happened, instead of believing for a miraculous power gospel of Jesus, we've got a humanistic gospel of Jesus, which is all to do with reasoning, rationalization, and reserve. Now, when the mind becomes stronger than the spirit, we've got problems. The man who has lost his reasoning is a man that you cannot reason with. Who agrees with me that reasoning is not the key to understanding faith? That doesn't mean you throw your brain away. A Christian with a brain is dangerous. But what that means is, come on, everybody, touch your mind. Say, my mind must be renewed, not removed. by the word of God. What is the Bible? The B-I-B-L-E. Yes, that's the book for me. Basic instructions before leaving earth. Your mind is renewed not by the telegraph, not by the times, certainly not the mirror, unless it's this mirror. And if it's the sun, make sure it's the S-O-N, not the S-U-N. Burn the S-U-N. It does not contain the image or the glory of God. Can I get an amen? Somebody say, good preaching, Pastor. All good preaching. All good preaching. You missed that, Peter. Burn the sun, the S-U-N. Can I get an amen? And say, turn to the sun, the S-O-N. And so we read the verse and it says, for I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. Have you ever felt a little bit like that? Everybody. Here we go together. I'm going to take my jacket off now because I'm feeling the heat. I feel the heat of the Holy Spirit going all over me. Thank you, darling. Whew. Pretty warm in here, isn't it? I'll just roll my sleeves up a bit there. Let's do it together. My speech. My preaching. Do it with me. Was not with persuasive words of human wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith. I want you to point your neighbor and say, that your faith. That your faith should not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Hallelujah. In the power of God. In the power of God. And when the Lord began to speak to me, he began to say, son, look at all the years, more than 30 years of crisscrossing the globe, of preaching the gospel. What has caused more people to come to the foot of cross than to come to the foot of the cross than anything else you've ever seen? And do you know what it's been, folks? Miracles. Now, the greatest miracle is salvation. But if you know, even Paul, when he tried to reason with them on Mars Hill, he used his intellect, he used his rationalization, but nobody got converted. Which is why Paul, later in his ministry, he begins to understand the power of the miraculous. Listen, the Bible tells us in the book of Corinthians, going quickly, there are 9 gifts of the Spirit. If you try to do evangelism without the anointing of the Holy Spirit, without the gifts of the Holy Spirit, it's like pulling teeth out in a dentist chair without an anesthetic. Who's ever had a tooth pulled out? I did when I was a youngster. I never forget the name of the dentist. His name was Butcher. That should have been a clue. I'm telling you, his name was Mr. Butcher. I couldn't believe it. I was about 8 or 9 years of age. He pulled several teeth out. And I'm telling you, in those days, I don't think the anesthetic worked. Which meant when my mother wanted to take me to the dentist, I said, no. I wouldn't go to the dentist for years after Mr. Butcher. I wonder where he is today. God bless him. I've forgiven him. I've become a born-again Christian. But I'm telling you, getting your teeth pulled out is painful. Can I get an amen? Now, trying to share the gospel without, come on, say, without the anointing of the Holy Spirit, the wisdom of the Holy Spirit, the power of God, is just as difficult. Why? Because it's the oil. Say, it's the oil. Romans 8:14, as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Let me give you a statistic. Let's say this together. 98% of Christians worldwide don't share their faith. 98% of leaders worldwide don't share their faith. Who believes that Jesus gave us the Great Commission? If he gave us the Great Commission, it's not the Great Suggestion. How many of you will be honest enough to admit that the reason you don't do it is because of fear? And the rest of you, thank you for being here today. Have a nice day. Come on, be honest. Intimidation and fear. Come on, come on. That's everybody in the church. Come on, me included. The reason you don't share your faith is fear. You're intimidated. You don't think you've got the answer. You don't think you know what to say. You don't think God will use you. Come on. Now let's say it together. Well, hands are lifted now. We're telling the truth. Say, Lord, for this purpose, the Son of God was manifested that he might destroy the works of the devil. Now while your hands lifted in faith and watching on the broadcast, say, Jesus, destroy the works of the devil in my life and let a spirit of faith operate in me to move in the miraculous and in the gifts of the Spirit in Jesus' name. And folks, I want to tell you, it's not like pulling teeth, it's like breathing. Everybody just breathe, just go. It's natural. Now, who agrees? You can just breathe, you go. Let the burden roll off your shoulders, because it's not your burden. It's not my burden. It's His. We're supposed to carry Matthew 11:28. Come on, everybody, lift your hand and say, Jesus said, my yoke is easy. My burden is light. So why are you walking around, you know, you're all strung out, I'm a Christian, and you're like, you're constipated. I'm glad to see 4 or 5 people laugh. Who's ever been constipated? Don't put your hands up. Who's ever? But who knows that that's not a pleasant thing. Can I get an amen? It's not a pleasant thing. I can tell you a true story. Once I had to pray for somebody. I won't tell you where, but it was a way away, and the poor fellow hadn't been for a while. Who thinks that could be painful? We prayed for him, and the glory of God hit him, and he ran. And if you've ever been constipated up for days and days and days, you would know what that's like. Praise the Lord. But how many of you agree that if you're natural, just smile. You're natural. Listen, you know, one of the first keys of helping God's people to relate to a world that's hostile is just smile. Be friendly. Ask their name. Look, don't even call it evangelism. Like I talk to everybody. This morning when I went to buy the bananas and the kiwi fruit for my wife to put in our juicer, I met an Italian man in there. He thought I was Italian. So I said, come sta, molto bene, tutto bene. How you doing? You're giving me a hug. I'll give you a hug. We're talking. We're chatting. Because if you're friendly, it opens doors. You know, at the minute I'm talking, tutto bene, how you doing? I said, are you washed in the blood? Are you redeemed? Are you born again? Is the Holy Ghost all over you? What do you think people will do if you say that sort of terminology? They run a mile. Listen, the first key, somebody say, the first key to supernatural evangelism is practice being normal. If only Christians were normal. The first key is a deliverance anointing to God's people to stop being weird. Can I get an amen? Amen. Don't speak in a stained glass accent. Don't say, Jesus Christ. You just be normal. Imagine if I spoke, yea, saith the Lord, O wife, yea. Let us go forth and do the shopping at Morrison's. Yea, old God speaketh yea. Come on. Somebody say, get normal. Touch a person beside you. Give them a high five and say, come on, just get normal. Get normal. That's the first key. Get normal. Everybody can do this. You know, folks, God called me to be an evangelist probably because I'm a pretty normal guy. I really don't like pretentiousness. I don't like performance. You know, there's nothing sacred about this here. In fact, I'm going to take it away. I'm going to take it away. It's just a metal pulpit. I'm going to just rip it out just like that. Look at that. Gone. Look at that. Now, it took me the best part of 50 years to develop a body like this. I want you to receive the full impact. You see, what happens in church, we become performance orientated. You know, and we start to act. The word hypocrite means to pretend. And I believe if we would just be normal. Everybody said, just be normal. Just love people. Ask for compassion. Don't even try to be too clever. Don't be too clever. The Bible says the heart of the righteous studies how to answer. The Bible says in Proverbs 15:24, the path of the wise winds up. But you know what? I've discovered the key. Somebody say, I've discovered the key. Over nearly 38 years of ministry, I love people. So say, I love people. I love God. So I love people. I love God. And I look for opportunity to pray for the sick, to minister to them. I don't go to the hostile. You don't, you know, sometimes Melissa, God bless her, she drags me in with all the atheists. Amen. So I'm like, thank you, Melissa, again. God bless you, Melissa. Because the atheists want to fight. I'm not embarrassing you, am I? I say, like, next time she calls me, I go, no, I'm deaf. I need a healing anointing and I can't hear. Because Melissa, God bless her, she's got the anointing to draw the most difficult people ever in Watford. And I don't know why she calls me over thinking I got the answer. She says, Pastor Steve, come on. I go, no, I can't hear, can't see. Well, Shandai, I don't know, I can't. Because they all want to fight. Now, I'm just kidding because she's growing. But you know what? The Lord's using her powerfully. But you know something? If you get engaged with the hostile, you can win an argument and lose a soul. Now, how many of you can understand that I'm not a cuddly bear? if somebody starts mocking Jesus or messing around, you know, I'm like, oh, that's nice. You know, I feel like Boanerges, the sons of thunder. I want to call down fire on them. Can I get an amen? Who understands that? You know, let's not pretend. Some of the things that atheists say and those of other persuasions is pretty disgusting stuff. And you've got to keep a good spirit of God to keep your equilibrium and just realize, use the egg timer. Somebody say, what's the egg timer? This is the egg timer. You have the soft eggs and you have the hard eggs. And in the French, they call it oeufs. Oeufs blandido. Come on, you should know this, Jenna. What is soft boiled eggs in the French? Is anyone here to help me? Oeufs de softy, the eggs. Oeufs de, what? De, the soft eggs. Everybody says the soft eggs, the hard eggs, and the hard boiled eggs. Now, you know what? The antagonists are the hard boiled eggs. Are you with me? So what you have to do is you have to use the egg timer for the soft eggs, which is 5 minutes. Everybody say fry. Un, deux, trois, quatre, cinq, six, trois, no, trois, 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 espagnol, trois. No more than 3 minutes. Now, I'm trying to teach you guys, but none of you listen. None of you listen, and you all get engaged with someone until they're screaming and they're shouting, their veins are popping out. And you think, well, that was a great witness, wasn't it? Are you with me? What should you do? I was with Geraldine, and I saw this woman coming down the street. I was trying to get her attention. Geraldine, I'm just trying to speak to her in Spanish. Geraldine, por favor, no diga nada sobre esa. Geraldine! And it reminded me of that song. Alan and Geraldine. Geraldine, don't talk to that woman, whatever you do. Geraldine, don't talk to her. So what does she do? She talks to her. Oh, no. Round about now, Pastor Creed, I wipe my glasses down. I can't see. I thought, Geraldine, please do not talk to that lady. Sure enough, she does. And then she says, Pastor. I'm like, oh, boy. I mean, and this woman, let's put it this way, the elevator doesn't go to the top floor, but she's particularly hostile and antagonistic. And so I'm trying to tell Geraldine in Spanish and in Filipino, just soft eggs. And Geraldine's looking at me like I'm speaking Chinese. So in the end, I said, Geraldine, we have the soft eggs, we have the hard-boiled eggs, and we have the hard fried eggs. And the woman's going, what's he talking about then? What's he on about, mate? What's eggs got to do with it? What's eggs got to do with it? I'm going, use the soft eggs, Geraldine, the soft eggs. And so Geraldine practiced the soft eggs and went, have a nice day. God bless you. Have a nice day. And walked away. And I said, thank you, Geraldine. This is the way you can do the evangelism without getting the pastor beat up. Sir, if you're having a hostile, do not call me over. Don't call me. Get on with it. Who are you going to call? Don't call me. Who are you going to call? Don't call me. Who are you going to call? Fix it yourself. If you got into the mess, get out of the mess. Can I get an amen? Everybody say, the soft boiled eggs is the answer. 2 to 3 minutes. And then just say, it's been so nice talking to you. You're not lying. It's the Holy Ghost. So it's so nice to have a nice day. And you walk away for another day. Say, walk away for another day. Or walk away for another day. Because it's going to take 6 to 8 contacts with the Western-minded people who are ruined by higher criticism, who do not believe in the miraculous, yet read their horoscope every day, which never tells them the full scope of their horror. Read the tea leaves and their palm leaves and practice a bit of meditation. Ooh. What are you doing? Meditating. Listen to me. Listen to me. I'm going to tell you the truth. I mean, you've got to laugh at this, Janet. But once I was preaching down in India, down in Mumbai, and you know what? I spoke to lots of people from persuasions of meditation. I asked one fellow, I said, do you know the way to salvation? He said, well, you got short path, medium path, long path, and a very long path. I said, which path are you on? He said, I'm not knowing. And we watched the program. And you know what, Winston? There was a man standing there like this. He had one arm up in the air and one leg like this. Like this. I said, what are you doing? He said, I'm standing. Why are you standing with one arm up in the air like this and one leg standing? Why are you standing such? It's very hard to do, actually, because you fall over with one. You got two. Said, how long have you been standing there? Said, very long time. How long? Said, long time. And he's down his arm now. He can't get his arm down. He said, why are you standing like this? He says, I am standing for the glory of God. You feel like saying, you, stupid is as stupid does. How do you know you are not standing for the glory of God? Can I get an amen? See, people are confused today. Standing for the glory of God with one hand up and one leg. What are you trying to say? It is not for the glory of God. It is for the glory of man. It is stupidity. Can I get an amen? What's it going to take to turn people of mindsets? Listen, some people's minds are like concrete, thoroughly mixed and permanently set. It's why we need the word of God to smash it open. We need the word of God to smash. What's it going to take? I'll tell you what, you can have all the reasoning in the world, like the sand glass. You can turn it over. You can talk for hours. It won't make any difference. You need the power of God. You need the gifts of the Spirit, word of faith, word of wisdom, healing, miracles, tongues, interpretation, Holy Ghost. You can cut through all of that with the power of God. Why? Because the word of God is supernatural in origin, eternal in duration, inexpressible in value, infinite in scope, regenerative in power, infallible in authority, universal in interest, personal in application, inspired in totality. Read it through, pray it in, work it out, passive. I believe the word. I operate on the word in faith, and that's why I pray for the sick. That's why I see miracles, and you know what? I want to focus on that. If someone's sick, go to pray for them. If you see the need, move by the Holy Ghost. Forget the soft eggs or the hard eggs. Go for those. Actually, look for the soft eggs. Do you know, I believe there are people drawn to heaven. Can I get an amen? There's people that are drawn to heaven. They're drawn to heaven. That's why they're drawn to you. Share the gospel with them. Share the gospel with them. Learn as you go to flow and operate in the power of the Holy Ghost. You know, with my wife, I love a prod from, when my wife prods me, it's supernatural. How many husbands are here say, you know it? So you got the Godhead, the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost, and then your wife somewhere in the Godhead. How many of you know what I'm talking about? She's right there. That's not heretical. That's just how much I esteem her. Anybody else understand that? There's only two guys in here, three, four, who are honest. The rest of you need to get married. Amen. Do you know what? It's a miracle thing, isn't it? I've told this story before, but I'll tell you again. I want to illustrate it before I give you some scripture, then I'm going to wrap it up. I'm going to pray for you today, all right? Yes? Who wants to flow in the miracle power of Jesus? You know what? It'll cut through all the rhetoric of your clever little arguments and your formulas, which actually never touch anyone. They never touch anyone. You need the power of God. You need the power of God. I'm in a vegetable shop with my wife in Argentina. I'm in my shorts. The Bible says the Lord takes not pleasure in the legs of a man. And I'm wandering around in the vegetable shop, singing to myself in psalms and hymns, which the Bible says to do, which I often do with my children. Suddenly my wife's going, baby. I love it when she calls me baby. Don't you try that stuff. Just my wife. And she, baby. So I go over, I say, yes, honey. She says, this man, he's going blind. I say, oh, that's a shame. She says, honey, he's going blind. I want you to pray for him. And I'm thinking, oh, darling, it's a vegetable shop. You know, how many of you know that, you know, when you're in here, the anointing's flowing. You know, Tino's playing the guitar. You feel the presence of God. When you're in a vegetable shop and they got Latin music going, boom, dickety, dink, boom, dickety, dink, boom, dickety, cabbages, oranges, melons, boom, dickety, dink. You don't feel like you got that Holy Ghost feel. Who knows what I'm talking about? And they're all in Argentina. They're all like, sí, che, come le va, che, gloria a Dios. Well, they're not saying gloria a Dios, but they're saying other things. And my wife says, he's going blind, pray for him. And I'm like, what? What? So I go up to the fellow, and my Spanish isn't great. How many of you know that? People say, how do you do it? I don't know. When I haven't had an interpreter, I've spoken in Spanish. I have no idea what they understand. But the best thing about it, Seba, is hundreds of people seem to come forward. It's amazing. Literally hundreds come forward and receive Jesus. So I don't know what I'm doing, but I'll just keep going in faith. What I do know is that when I don't know words, I swing my arms around and I move around. Gloria Dios, hallelujah, hallelujah, gloria Dios, hallelujah. Oh, si, 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 si. And it works. So I say to this fella in Spanish, I say, Señor. He says, eh. Big fella with bandages. I say, eh. I said, ¿tienes problema con su ojo? He says, sí. I said, ¿quiere mi orar para vos? He said, ¿qué? Which means, what? I said, can I pray for your eye? He said, ¿qué? I said, can I pray for your eye? And I've got to get English now because you won't understand it. He said, what? ¿Qué? What? Everybody said, ¿qué? What? What? He said, here? Aquí? With the music going, boom, tiki ching, chiki boom, chiki chiki, chiki boom, chiki. And I say, yes, here. And my wife's going, see, here, in front of everybody, in my shorts on. I don't feel the anointing. I haven't got my robes on. I haven't got my mitre on and my robes. I'm feeling, oh, I'm feeling sanctimonious and holy and religious and spiritual. Praise the Lord. I'm feeling all Christian and all, you know, with the, I haven't got my big cross out or anything. You know what I mean? I don't feel the incense. And you know what? I'm feeling very unanointed. Who's ever felt completely unanointed, unspiritual, unscriptural, and you feel like if you're going to pray for someone, they're just going to laugh at you? Anybody? You know what? When you're weakest, you're strongest. When you're weakest, you're strongest. When you're weakest, you're strongest. And you know what, Seba? I didn't even pray like a usual prayer like I do in church. Hallelujah, glory be to Jesus. Ah, yeah. Oh, I know you come up the front for something. Ha, ah, but I know you need healing. Ha, ah, and I know God's going to bless you today. Ha. Ah. So what's the ha ah business? I don't know, but you see a lot of preachers do it. You know what I did? I just put my hand up on his eye. And I just said, Father, heal this man in the name of Jesus. Walked away with the music going, boom, chicky, 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 boom, chicky, 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 boom. And I'm thinking, boy, I wonder what happened there. You know what the story is? Miraculously, totally, completely healed. Miraculously, completely, totally healed. Miraculously, completely, totally healed. And you know what? I don't want to forget this while I'm speaking to you today, because I could talk for hours. It's going to make no difference. I want to get into the new place with God where I'm dealing with those who are antagonistic, those who are hostile, but those who aren't, and say, listen, enough talking. Give me your hand. Let me demonstrate to you my God in Jesus Christ, and let me pray for you. Move in a word of knowledge, like the man I stopped in the street and I said, you got a heart condition. He said, how did you know? I said, I didn't. God just told me. Prayed for him, instantly healed. Can I get an amen? Like the time when I was just a young evangelist. I was young once. Always young once. She was 24 years of age. She came up with curvature of the spine. And I thought, what are you going to do now? I prayed for her and I heard it straighten up in front of me, healed. 24 years of age. Like the time I went to Conrad's bedside and they said to me, they thought I was the priest. They said, you take as long as you like. I thought, I've never said that before. Why have they said that? Do what you got to do. I thought, what? I went in. He was grey. He wasn't moving. He wasn't talking. I looked at him in the natural and I thought, that doesn't look good. It doesn't look good. You know what I did? I didn't do what other people do. I lifted my hands and I prayed in tongues for 15 minutes. Then I turned to him. I rebuked the spirit of death. I rebuked it and said, I command you, spirit of death, come out of him. Get off him. He's my accountant. He's not going to die. If you think I can do accounts, you've got to be kidding. I said, come back to life now. And after 15 minutes, the color went back into his cheeks. He looked up, he said, hello, Pastor. I said, all right, Conrad, go back to sleep. And turn around, I went back to bed. He went back to bed, I went back on the train, went back home. Folks, I believe he's raised from the dead. From that day, the cancer disappeared. Hallelujah. Come on, lift your hands and say, the power of God, 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 the power of God. Stop trying to do it in the flesh. Do you know the moment you stretch out your hands to operate in the miraculous, people will get born again, saved, healed, delivered much quicker. Who agrees with me? One time I was working in Bulgaria. I took 100 young people in to preach the gospel in Bulgaria and Romania. And we went to a place called Borgash. You ever heard of Borgash? It was a place with black sand on a beach. And I was preaching. And they took me to a gypsy community. And I'm preaching to this gypsy community. I love it. I mean, my whole life, all I've ever done is preach, teach, and reach. Can I get an amen? I don't know anything else. So I'm preaching the gospel, and then I said, okay, now you go and lay hands on the sick. So all these kids started laying, and you know what? Suddenly there was screaming and all kinds of people getting miraculously healed. Come on, I want you to look at your hands. Say, these hands, come on, look at them. Say, these hands are the hands of Jesus. Help me to stretch out my hands. These feet are the feet of Jesus. Say, I got the same mission, the same ministry, and it starts today. And you know what? Then this girl started screaming, this gypsy girl, but she couldn't scream, you know, she was like, it was like, wah! And so they said, Pastor, come over, it's a demon. But the Holy Spirit showed me it wasn't a demon. And as this girl was about 13, beautiful girl, 13, 14 years of age, she was at the top of her voice, voices were coming out. The people there, they said, Pastor, it's a demon. And I went over, I looked at the girl, and at the moment I looked at her, I knew what it was. She was deaf and dumb, and now she could hear and was starting to speak for the first time. Folks, deaf and dumb, and she's going, deaf and dumb. Hallelujah. Now, before you think, oh, Pastor Steve, stop and think again. And every one of you lift up your hands and say, God is not looking for some superstar. He ain't looking for Benny Hinn or Brian Hinn or Billy Hinn or all the Hinns. Come on, lift up your hands. Say, he's looking for me. He's looking for you. He's looking for you. He's looking for you. And somebody say, he's looking for Joe. Ouch. And say, in the name of Jesus, say, it's time to get up and start to pray and start to move in the power of God. Because it's not me, it's the greater one who's in me. You see who's in me? The greater one. Say 1 John 4:4. Jesus is in me and he's in you. Colossians 1:27, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Let me give you some scriptures to wrap this up today. Scriptures, Exodus 15:26. Is anybody up for this? You know what? I don't want to keep on doing evangelism like grinding teeth. And using, listen, folks, I want to tell you something. I've learned every technique there is to learn on evangelism. It's why I've written the books. Can I get an amen? Amen. But here's what you've got to do. You've got to put aside your reasoning. Put aside what you think is the way to do it. Even using the law of God, it's great, but that's not the formula. Can I get an amen? I want you to say this after me. Unless the Holy Spirit is moving on the person, convicting of sin, righteousness, and judgment, John 16:8, you are preaching at a brick wall. Can I get an amen? And your preaching may be doing harm rather than doing good. Exodus 15:26. Here's what we need. Somebody say, here's what we need. Somebody say, good preaching, Pastor. Great preaching on Hannah's birthday, on Winston and Nina's anniversary, engagement. No, not right. I'll tell you what, they've done all in a service. Glory be to Jesus. A lot can happen at church. Miraculous moving forward. Come on, say miracles are for today. You've got to stretch out your faith. You know what? If somebody is blind and gets healed, they turn to Christ. If someone's dying of cancer and they turn to Christ, they know it. How many of you are in this church because God touched you supernaturally? Some of you had dreams, visions. Listen, let's stop doing Christianity the evangelical way, boring, stiff, and dead. And struggling, and let's start doing it the Bible way. Can I get an amen? Let's start doing it the way the Bible says, with signs and wonders. And it's not you. You say, well, I don't want to do anything. That we know that. Let the Lord do it then through you. Somebody says, well, I met one people up here in Watford, very spiritual. They said, well, we don't want to do it in the flesh. I said, well, great. Stay at home. Keep watching the television, eating boxes of chocolates, and, you know, send your spirit out. He'll do it. Come on, somebody, say, grow some legs. Grow some faith. People say to me all the time, have you got a signs and wonders ministry? I say, no, signs and blunders. But I keep going. I've told you many, many times how I started. I started praying for animals, not people. My mother had a cat called Sylvester. It was a Persian chinchilla. Who knows what that is? It's a big, fluffy cat. Through faith and prayer, it turned into a dog. Well, it was like a dog, but it was really a cat. Listen, that cat had more ailments, diseases, and problems than any cat you ever saw. It had lumps, bumps, cancers, all kinds of things. Sometimes she'd take it to the vets, Ebba. The vet would say, I can't do anything for it. Call your son. I got a bit of a reputation as Dr. Doolittle. I'm telling you the God's honest truth. When that cat saw me sitting in the corner, Sylvester the cat, the dog, he would make cat noises. Because he knew what was coming. Praise be unto the Lamb of God. He knew what was coming. I said, get me the bottle of olive oil. And that poor cat in the corner was. Next thing I get, come here, Sylvester. Boosh. A gallon of oil on that cat's head. Listen, that cat went way beyond nine lives. That cat kept on going. Last I heard, he was an apostle. I'm just kidding. He's gone. That cat's gone to cat heaven. I'm telling you, Peter, that cat was a Holy Ghost cat. Yes, yes. And he knew. He knew when he saw me. Sylvester the cat, the dog. Healed by the glory of God. And I got faith for that. I started getting faith. Faith. I could pray for anyone. Pray for anything. I feel that this morning. You know what? If the doctor said you're going to be crippled, you're not. If the doctor said you got bad lungs, you're not. If the doctor said you need a new carburetor, we'll stick a new one in. He's got plenty of spare parts. It's not Edge retreads. It's Holy Ghost kingdom parts. So you need get a new leg. Need a new eye, get a new eye. Get a new head. I'm just kidding. Stick with the one you got. You might need it. Is anybody out there? Just give me a wave and say, come on, it makes sense. It makes sense. Exodus 15:26. Are you ready? Here we go. Here's the scriptures. Here's the keys. Ready? Write this down. Take out a pen. Write this down. Here we go. Jesus said, if you will diligently heed my voice, and you do what's right, you give ear to my commandments, you keep all my statutes, none of these diseases will come upon you. Say, none of the diseases. None of these diseases. Listen, stop believing for thrombosis, diabetes, cancer. Curse it all! Decree over your life divine health! My wife will tell you, I don't take pills. Some people I know talk about pills. They've got a pill for this, a pill for that, a pill for this, a pill. They're living on pills, hypochondriacs. Get healed in the name of Jesus. Somebody give me an amen. Amen. Now don't tell your doctor I said that, but you come to faith. Can I get an amen? Amen? Listen, I'm not against doctors, medical doctors. They're doing the best they can, but there's a better way. Can I get an amen? Come on, somebody say divine health, divine life, divine anointing to live a supernatural life. Of miracles, gifts of the Spirit, word of wisdom, word of knowledge, faith, miracles. Here, is anyone interested in this? What are you looking for in church? What are you looking for in church? A message that'll tickle your intellect, that'll motivate you with a bit of psychology, or do you really want? Who wants to really live a Christian life? Come on now, lift up your hands. Who wants to live the life of fire for God? Are you listening, Santi? Who wants to live the life of fire for God? Fire for God to heal the sick. Come on, raise the dead. Preach the gospel. Cast devils out. Advance the kingdom. Take territory. Start businesses. Overcome. Take over! I'm just going to apply my own message to myself and scream. Jesus says this. He says, none of these filthy diseases of the Egyptians will I put on you. For I am the Lord who heals you. Come on, say, I'm the Lord who heals you. Let me give you a couple more this morning. Look at that. It's so anointed. The pages are moving. They're flying all over the nations. Psalm 103, verse 3. Come on, everybody, lift your hands. Say, he forgives every iniquity. He heals every disease. Every iniquity, every disease. Psalm, you say, well, I can't get there. Then give me the prayer request and I'll send the word. Psalm 107, verse 20. He sent his word and delivered them. We have prayed for people there and God has healed them. Somebody say, prayer is the butterfly effect. Hallelujah. You can pray here and God will heal them there. We've seen it many, many times. Who remembers the butterfly effect? In 1963, Edward Lorenz, he said that when butterflies move, they release molecules into the atmosphere that interact with other molecules. That over a period of time can make a hurricane start on the other side of the earth. Those of you that were here last week, wave your hands. Now lift your hands up and say, Father, let a butterfly effect start in me right now, that if I pray for the sick, if I release a word, if I speak a word, it might be released someplace else, somewhere else, that will release somebody else to flow into a miracle. My whole life's a series of miracles. Don't put Jesus with Buddha or Muhammad or Krishna. His birth was miraculous. His life was miraculous. His death was miraculous. His resurrection was miraculous. Muslims are incorrect. Jesus rose from the dead. Hallelujah. He is the Son of God. He is the Savior of the world. He is the healer, the deliverer, the baptizer in the Holy Ghost. He is the soon and coming King. Don't put Jesus on the same level as Buddha or Muhammad or Krishna. He is the Son of God. He's alive forevermore. Can't even mention them in the same breath, because Jesus died on the cross and rose again from the dead. He's the living incarnation. He's God made flesh. Rose from the dead. Conquered sin, death, and hell. Hallelujah. Lord, glory be to Jesus. Makes every bone in my body move. Hallelujah. I feel like I'm 18 when the anointing's on me. Later on, I might discover I'm still 56, but right now. Oh, yeah. Mess with me when I'm under the anointing. Oh, praise be unto God. I feel good now. I could crush an entire box of bananas today. Come on, somebody. Touch a neighbor beside you. Say, come on, Jesus is waiting on you. Come on, Jesus is waiting on you. Jesus is waiting on you. Matthew 4:23, it says, and Jesus went around all Galilee, teaching in every synagogue, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, healing all kinds of sickness, every kind of disease and demon among the people. Matthew 9:35, Jesus went to every city, every village, teaching in the synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, healing every sickness, disease among the people. Lift your hands and say, Jesus, healer, savior, deliverer, baptizer in the Holy Ghost, the power of God, 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 the supernatural power of God. Mark 16:17-18. These signs will follow those that believe. In my name, they'll cast out devils. They'll speak with new tongues. They'll take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it won't hurt them. They'll lay hands on the sick. Come on. Lay your hands on the sick. Lay your hands on the sick and they'll recover. You got the anointing. You got the anointing. You got the power. Stand up with me. Lift your hands. Acts 10:38. I got anointed Jesus with the Holy Ghost and power. He went around doing good, healing all who were oppressed of the devil. Healing all who were oppressed of the devil. James 5:15-16, the prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if you've committed sins, they'll be forgiven. Confess your trespasses one to another. Pray for one another. Come on, everybody, pray for one another. Pray for one another. And the effective prayer will heal your soul, set you free. 1 Peter 2:24. Himself bore your sins on the body, on the cross, that Jesus Christ would heal you. Lift your hands and say, by his stripes I'm healed. Come on, lift your hands, say, by his stripes I'm healed. Say, by his stripes I'm healed. 3 John 2. Beloved, I pray that you would prosper in all the will of God. You'd have health. You'd have prosperity. Oh, signs and wonders. Isaiah 53. Himself bore our infirmities, and by his stripes I'm healed. Come on, lift your hands and say, by his stripes I'm healed. Love, release the supernatural power of God. Wounded for my transgressions, he was bruised for my iniquities. The chastisement of my peace was upon him, and by stripes, by stripes, by stripes, I'm healed. I'm healed. Yeah, I'm healed.